So did the professors and Dean Wyckoff pay you to come? I'm really honored to come. And I've got 100 slides. And I need to do it in a half an hour. How long do I have?
3 4 hours.
Three, four hours. I hope you brought food. There will be a bathroom break at 6. I've been blessed to have a degree in environmental/public health. As I've met with the professors today, those of us that have an environmental health degree will always, it's like a Marine, will always be an environmental health officer. And at the same time, I am really thrilled with what's going on, where we went from environmental health to applied health and safety to public health, because I've gone through watching public health grow exponentially, environmental health exponentially. And I think the ETSU program is mirroring that. And I'm really humbled. I'm really thrilled to be here. It's quite the honor. I stopped back by on a drive coming back from a funeral to Panama City, and I said, oh, ETSU. So traffic was bad on 95, so I rolled in. I met Dr. Wyckoff, and we started talking, and we discussed it at breakfast. He's been blessed to be a bureaucrat in D.C., and he's got a storied career, and he's under his leadership, he's doing so much here. But we both, I think we agree, don't we, Dean? You can't forget the basics. You can't forget the basics of environmental health. And I used to introduce people because I believe, and I'll talk more about it. I had a group dynamics class in leadership. I don't know what you called it, Dr. Bishop, but it was, Craig went more about not just public health, but he talked about the importance when you go in for an interview, how to sit, the importance of how to talk to people, the importance of a handshake. And those people skills, along with curriculum or knowledge background, you got to have them both. And so when I used to try to get people's attention and go, hi, I'm Mike Gillenwater, I defend the world against diarrhea and bad beer, not necessarily in that order. And I still do that. But, and I'll get into it in the slides. Again, I've got 100 slides, but we're going to blaze through them. 9/11 changed all our lives. And I stepped up to be part of Homeland Security. So now, hey, I'm Mike Gillenwater. I defend the world against bad beer, diarrhea, and bad guys. Simple thing is, you've learned this in your environmental health, public health courses. You put a barrier between you and the bad people. And I've been able to take that mentality as we fight the world against terrorism. So thanks again, Dr. Wyckoff. Thanks, Janet. Thank you. I mean, I can't appreciate what you've done. So you guys ready to go for a ride? Yeah. This is my life. I'm still here, though, right? I'm still here. It all started way back when, what do you think? Finding a picture of Dr. Bishop is tough. I had to go onto the website to find this. But years back, I was born in Saltville, Virginia. Anybody from Saltville? No one's from Saltville? Left there when I was 5 years old, moved up to Charlottesville, home of the university. Just thought I'd tell you that. Anyway, my dad couldn't afford my education, so I joined the Army as a medic. And I went overseas in Europe. I was a medic. I was a chem lab tech. Brian and I were talking about, I used to run a gas chromatograph that would stretch from here to there, as well as an atomic absorber and everything else. But in my building were the environmental health engineers. And they go, Mike, we need a technician. So I started going out doing environmental health surveys, air, sewage, air pollution, noise pollution, BODs, CODs. I was the one that would climb up the smokestack, and in Tehran in 1978, they decided to shoot at me, and I was such a great soldier. The lieutenant goes, Gillenwater, you need to get down. And of course, I asked why. He said, they're shooting at you. I got right down. But so I came back, and my wife and I went to Emory and Henry, and we were looking at the education department and the environmental health department. I came in, and I met Dr. Morgan. Now, I kind of like this slide, because if you didn't know Dr. Morgan, he was back in 1969, and he understood the importance of basic environmental health, but he also understood the importance of international health. So even back in the 80s, right, Dr. Bishop, we had people from all over the world right here in Johnson City. And some of those contacts, when I was in Africa and everything else, I've used them. So two things I want you to get through this whole darn thing. First of all, I want to entice you that you're in this room because Dr. Meyer and I talked about it. You get it. You get it. I hope you love it. If you're in the school, I hope I entice you to show you. I couldn't keep a job, so I've got all kinds of opportunities out here. But I'm going to entice you for that. If you're in the profession, I hope I reinforce that you're doing something that's really important to either your community, your region, or your world. Before I start rocking and rolling, disclaimer on the boots, I've got old man disease. I fell downstairs, a whole flight of three of them, in a house I've lived for 30 years, and I sprained my foot. So I have to keep them in the boot to move on. But I wouldn't miss this for anything. I've got the little quote, a professor is one who talks in someone else's sleep. You get that? You understand that? A teacher or professor does their job. And I wake up at 3 in the morning going, did Dr. Bishop say that? You know. And special thanks to those who inspired me. Dr. Morgan emphasized the basics. Dr. Eaglar, we would have tea in our Thursday night class. We would have tea. And he made me realize that you got to study policy. And when the resource conservation, we took a RCRA course with Dr. Eaglar. It was not fun, but we realized the importance of studying regulations and policy. Then I became a policy writer, and it was no fun. Dr. Secor, if you didn't know him, he was a lawyer. He was tenacious. In my orals, he scared the heck out of me. He challenged you. It was phenomenal. And then Dr. Bishop is one of those mentors that we do Christmas cards. We keep in touch with family and kids and everything else. And I that is my mentor, and I hope you find a mentor and you're blessed as much as I was. Don't cry, Craig. Don't cry. So somehow I got Dr. Bishop at a weak moment. He became my advisor. Dr. Meyer and I went up and we pulled up my master's. Mine's the thinnest one up there, but I was able to make it through. I dropped my thesis off at his house at a Thanksgiving morning. We had a great time. But Dr. Bishop would spend his summers in the Public Health Service, National Park Service, Montana, wherever. And he was asked to teach a course on cross-contamination in Albuquerque in the summer of 1983. And he and I got, and what kind of car was that? Delta 88, and we road tripped to Albuquerque. So we got to know each other. I had no idea what the Public Health Service was because I was a prior Army grunt. And next thing I knew, I was off to Alaska. They called me, we discussed this earlier, and offered me a job in North Dakota. I said yes. 15 minutes later, they called me and offered me a job in Alaska. I said, bummer. And they go, we'll take care of that. So, real quick, left here, spent 3 years in Alaska with the Native Americans. They discovered oil, remember that, back in the late 1977? Well, when they discovered oil in Alaska in 1977, the North Slope was a territory. They said, oh, we better make it an entity and make it a borough. Wait a minute, we need 7 villages, so let's move these nomads back here. So let's start up these villages. Well, there was no concept of sanitation. There was no concept for this because you had nomads. So I was honored to be the first public health, sanitarian, environmental health guy on the North Slope. And I also covered the Beltway. So anyway, 3 years in Alaska, 2 years with the Mescalero Apache Reservation. In the late 80s, multiple gastrointestinal outbreaks on cruise ships. An Army buddy of mine was tasked to run it. We developed, who's been on a cruise? The USPHS standards, we started that. Can you believe that? An environmental health guy from ETSU helped write those regs. So I was loving life as a public health service officer in Miami. My wife was going to graduate school. We had a house with a pool. What happened in the early 90s? Desert Storm, Desert Shield. No, Desert Storm, not Desert Shield, Desert Storm. That's good enough. I got a call from a master chief in the United States Coast Guard who said, Commander Gillenwater? I said, yes, sir. He says, we'd like to welcome you to the Coast Guard. I go, no, I'm public health service. He goes, no, you're U.S. Coast Guard. And what happened was, it was a time of war. The Coast Guard, in their fantastic mission, had hired 3 PhDs, and due respect to you PhD doctorate types, but they had no field environmental public health preventive medicine experience. So the computers were just starting up, they looked at it, and they found 2 of us, former corpsmen, former medics, degrees in environmental health, and they said, go develop the preventive medicine program. So I was able, during time of war, to take care of the PAC area and develop their preventive medicine program. After the Coast Guard, I ended up with the National Park Service as a public health consultant for Virginia, Maryland, West Virginia, D.C., all the special events in D.C., to include Camp David and the White House. Following that, my career waned. I spent a little time with the FDA. Dr. Bishop and I taught courses around the nation. My son, we thought he had an illness. It turned out he's fine, but I retired. And I worked for the local health department, but 9/11 changed all our lives. So I got back in the game with Homeland Security. I was hired as an auditor with TSA because I'm a former public health inspector. Pre-9/11, there were 4,000 pieces of security equipment out there owned by the airports and the airlines. Congress got together, developed TSA, and said, build, deploy 7,000 more at $1 million each. So I was hired to TSA to do a quality assurance on that equipment. Ironically, my time on the AA and the GC, they kind of run the same way. And so I went back to that. I was immediately, they said, oh, this guy knows how to make botulinum in his kitchen. And so I ended up on the red team, and we'll get into that. Then I got into infrastructure protection. 9/11 Commission Act said pipeline security, we'll get into that. And then I was honored to run one of the FEMA grants programs. That's all, I just couldn't keep a job. Okay, a real fun career. So I just wanna give you that as an overview. And you ready to rock now? Who's been to Alaska? Ryan, you've been there? Where have you been?
Fairbanks.
Where is it? Fairbanks? Where else?
Gangway, Tolk.
Oh, really? What'd you do?
Oh, just travel.
Just travel?
In an RV.
All right, so you drove up, Tolk.
Alaska.
How long did it take you?
Oh, we spent the whole summer. We went up to the Yukon.
Yeah. So, 1984, I left good old Johnson City. We drove the Alaska Highway. It takes 3, 4, 5 days. And if you look at this, Alaska is divided by, you've got the Alaska Range down here, you've got the Brooks Range up here, and you've got the Yukon, that goes through and comes out here. Southern Alaska, Kenai Peninsula, interior, Barrow. They said, hi, Mike, welcome to Alaska. You're in charge of the villages from, where are we? From, where's the screen? Where anyway? From Toke down here to Nikolai McGrath, which sits right at the base of Mount McKinley, to Talkeetna, up on the west coast to Caltag, Koyukuk, to Ruby, Tananaw, along the river, all these villages, Allakaket, we'll come back to that. Anaktuvuk Pass sits right on the top of the Brooks Range. That's where the caribou come from the interior annually. They go back and forth to the North Slope. The North Slope, the elevation here is about 10 feet above sea level. Now, you know, over here in the Arctic National Refuge, you're about 8,000. So I covered 48 villages from Mount McKinley to the North Slope. Every other week, I would get in a little bitty airplane, I would fly in the village, and I had carte blanche to try to improve their public health. Quickly, they realized, who's this white guy from Tennessee with no credibility? So I didn't get any respect, and this is a cultural thing, till the second or third time I went back. So I had to teach classes. I chose to teach classes in the schools. I taught history. I told to do whatever else. I worked with the health department as a former medic. I stitched, and if any physician asked me, I'll deny it. I hauled wood to get credibility, because my job was to change the culture, and I had support to do that. Now, watching the time real quick, Alaska is divided into five basic Native American cultures. Today, I'm going to talk about how I spent time with the, how I spent time with the Athabascans and the Inupiaqs on the North Slope. Now, I've got an Eskimo name, Kanuk Tunik, because at 5'10", I was the tallest guy. So when we played basketball, I got to finally dominate. As you can tell, I'm a klutz, but they call me Kanuk Tunik, crazy white man, because I was a bear. I mean, Shaq had nothing over me. I mean, I it was a hoot. But I want you to realize that, because if you study Native culture, I also worked with the Apache, who are Athabascan. The Athabascans nomaded up through Canada and everything else. The Inupiaqs are Eskimo that came over from Russia. Finally, I'm boogieing, but if you have questions, please ask them as we go through, okay? So, in my travels, I crossed the Arctic Circle on trips 32 times. A couple times we had to walk away from airplanes, a couple times we left them where we landed them, but that's a whole nother story. So, 32 times across the Arctic Circle. And you're going to see later, I came back to the Arctic Circle when I was with Homeland Security. This is what I did on Monday or Tuesday mornings. This is how I got around. Sometimes, believe it or not, a dog sled, a boat, or wherever else. We would fly till 40 below. Why would we stop at 40 below? Gas. So when you don't want to be flying and your gas freezes. It's just not a good thing. So Monday, Tuesday morning, we get out. We load up basically the mail planes. This is the interior. This is where I would be Monday morning or Tuesday morning. This is where I went to work. This is the Yukon frozen. I know in some of your courses they've talked about how populations have lived along water and rivers. Well, guess where they live in Alaska? Waters and rivers. Well, it's great to live on a river. Why? You got good drinking water coming down, and it's a great thing to throw your trash so it can go on down. Let's not worry about the village down below. But that was the mentality years ago. So these are interiors. Flying along a different village along the Yukon. This is in the village of Talkeetna, right at the bottom of Denali. Some of the village populations were 20, some were 50, some were 100. Again, I would show up Monday or Tuesday. They got to know me. My job was to get to know the people. The state of Alaska didn't have a lot of travel money, so I also inspected the grocery stores, a restaurant if it was there, their environmental health conditions, their sewage, their stewage. I would also do that. Typical Alaska, you don't see this on your travel magazines. Now the cultures are changing because of the internet, but this is back in the 80s. This is the school right here on the left. Can you guys see okay? Salmon, their subsistence, the Native Americans, it's subsistence living. When I would go into the villages, a lot of times I would have to step over caribou or moose or fish to go meet the chief. You got your door, you got your foyer, where they store the meat, on the floor, everything else, and I'd step over it. They didn't have refrigerators. And so basic sanitation concepts, again, what the dean and I talked about, it was heir apparent then. But vacationing when you're in the interior of Alaska is you go to your fish camp along the Yukon River. You have a fish wheel or a net, and you just catch salmon all summer long. And then you cure them with salt, you hang them for you and your dogs. Typical, each village has a health aide that's taught to be basically the initial screening for any medical problems. I kind of like this slide because up here it says, tells you not to drink. The top of the poster in regards to behavioral health is the spirits tell you not to drink because alcoholism is such a problem in Native America. The biggest problem that I dealt with is rabies. Rabies was endemic in Alaska in the 1970s, 80s, 50s, and it's still endemic in Arctic populations. My buddy who was the vet on the North Slope, who I knew, Dr. Les Dalton, he and I knew each other in the Army. Through the University of Alaska, we wrote a grant, they supported it, and I wrote a grant so I could trap. They paid for my travel, they paid for my traps, and we did a survey where we spent two winters trapping Arctic fox. 50% of them are rabid. So we've discussed this, and I don't want to offend anybody. This is a public health class, and I certainly don't want to offend you, but here's one of the foxes. This baby was rabid. It's clean. It's fine. It's 30 years old. But 50% of these that we caught were rabid. What does that tell you? That if you've got a loose dog bouncing around, he gets bit by a fox. What does that do with the host vector thing? What did I do with the thing? Senility. Thank you very much. So I really spent a ton of time with the dog controls. Because remember, if the snow machine breaks down, how do you get around? Your dogs. If your dogs get loose, they can be bit by a raccoon, a fox, everything else. So we realized if we vaccinated the dogs, we could help prevent that rabies problem. Typical dog yard is 50 to 300 dogs. Susan Butcher, Libby Reynolds. Libby Reynolds is the first female to win the Iditarod. I vaccinate her dogs. I got no acknowledgement for that. Oh yeah, our government vaccinated my dogs, but I won the Iditarod. You know, I would go into the village. I would go to the dog yard. I would have rabies needles on my right, distemper needles on my left, We would hit them for rabies, IQ up in the neck, I mean for distemper, and we'd do rabies through the back. Many times, I would have to hold the dog while the needle thawed so I could inject it. Because at 20 below, you know, so there I am in a dog yard, a dog's bark going at me here, and I'm doing it. We saw, and we didn't do a lot of official surveys, but we could see the reduction of transmission of rabies in dogs and people. We really felt like the lay vaccinator program worked. Proof, I talked about the village of Allakaket. Someone was doing an article. I didn't make it up, you know. And so there I am vaccinating Eddie Bergman's dogs. You can see I'd have to hold it in there, find the skin, deal with them, and inject them. Now, what do you see in this picture? This is frozen, by the way. So to show you some of the conditions of rural Alaska, I found some soap and I set it down there. What does this do for basic sanitation? Where do you go? Anybody from West Virginia? Just, you know, I that's right, sir. I mean, you know why West Virginians have a two-seat outhouse? Craig's heard the story. So a husband and wife can go together. I've got a sailor part of that, but I'm not going to go there. All right. Dean Wyckoff and I have talked about this. Remember, I had carte blanche for public health. So if I could get these villages to put a water system in, a community well, I was ecstatic. Dr. Meyer and I talked about where he used to grow up in North Dakota, where you didn't worry about the water. The aquifers were good. But you just, if we could get a well and we're good. If I could get them to chlorinate it, I was ecstatic. And if I could convince them to do a fluoridator, that was icing on the cake. And a couple villages, after 3 years, we saw the dental problems go down because we got fluoride in the kids' water. Now, we had to deal with the whole thing that fluoride's toxic and everything else, but we did our best to convince them. Okay, that was the interior. Now we're going to head where it gets really cold, crossing the Brooks Range, across Anaktuvuk Pass. Oh, by the way, Anaktuvuk Pass, where the caribou go through. Years ago at Halloween, everybody goes, wow, that's a great Native American thing that's gone back in tradition for years. Well, no, the people in Anaktuvuk Pass said, hey, it's Halloween. Let's make some masks. So now you go to Anchorage or Fairbanks, you see all these great traditional arts. They started out as Halloween masks. So you've got caribou hide and Arctic fox fur around it. This is Barrow, Alaska. To make sure that we proved on my introduction, that's the runway. And there you are, the northernmost city in the United States of America. Whenever I would see a paved runway, I was happy. And they also, I knew they had a restaurant here. I was thrilled. They're subsistence living. They still whale. They still trap. Even now, they still do it. Is our conditions in our world making a difference on the whole impact of the temperature going up? Heck yes. But there's a sealskin walrus boat. Now, when you're dealing where it's snow on the ground from October till May, and in Barrow the sun sets in October and it comes up in May, you have to figure out a way for basic plumbing, basic sanitation, everything else. So what they've done in some of the cities is it's either above where you have access to and it's heated, or they have a thing called a utilidor underneath where they run the piping through. You just kind of have to deal with the weather. This is the village of Wainwright, Alaska. That would be the Arctic Ocean out there, the Chukchi Sea. This is welcome to the city of Akasuk, population 215. Now, I talked about they made it a borough. So they took nomad families and moved them around. They said, oh, we need health clinics. We need water systems. Let's build a $5 million health clinic for 215 people with a health aide who sees a patient once a week. I liked it because some of the villages in the interior, I had to, wind would come through the log cabin and I keep wood all night long. This baby had a microwave. I was thrilled. The state did not have a lot of money, so I was their inspector. And back to the whole group dynamics thing, I went back and I said, they're dumping raw sewage into the Arctic Ocean. And they go, no, they're not. I go, yes, they are. And they go, no, they're not. So the next slide you see, I blew up in posters, and I went to the state legislator and presented this next presentation. Public Health Service was ecstatic. The state of Alaska is still, I'm still not their favorite person. So basically, that pipe is where the sewage is dropped from the health clinic. You got a $5 million clinic, but you got to take the backhoe up to get the sewage out of it. Now, is it connected tightly there? Could there be spillage? You got raw sewage, you got everything else. Let's drive it through the city and let's take it out to dump. But this is in the interior. This is not the one that I got my notoriety. Wainwright, they got a real truck. And they would pick it up, load up the sewage from the buildings. I got them back into the ocean, dumping raw sewage in the Arctic Ocean. I love environmental health. The state of Alaska, I'm not their favorite person. But I believe I made a difference in public health. Any Alaska questions? What'd you think? Pretty cool?
Good question.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
50% of the foxes were rabid.
That we trapped.
Did it kill them or were they able to survive with it?
The ones we tested?
The ones
we tested didn't make it, sir.
In the wild population?
No, the population survived.
So they were basically infected carriers.
Infected carriers, almost asymptomatic sometimes. I mean, yeah. So, one couple more pictures. Trying to get credibility in there, because I grew up in Southwest Virginia. I grew up through hunter safety. I was a hunter safety trained instructor. I did a hunter safety course because a lot of our safety problems were hunting accidents. At 40 below, we had to practice indoors. So we used BB guns. Not everybody you see a rifle range with a kitchen in the background. I don't know who the skinny guy is on the left right there, but also you can see this guy. His name is Isaac Nupakibak. I gave him his first job. He ended up being the president of the Nupiak tribe. So when I was a bureaucrat in D.C., it was nice to know Isaac. My wife got tired of no sunshine and 60 below. She taught at North Pole, Alaska. She would get up in the morning at 5 a.m., plug her car in, put the heater blanket on, drive 30 miles, teach, drive 30 miles back. I was either flying in the villages or I had a half a mile commute to my job. But she was a great American. She got tired of that. She got tired of the darkness. And I was asked to go be the service unit sanitarian in Mescalero. And I'm going to go fairly quick. Mescalero sits between El Paso and Albuquerque. It's the Apache, Chiricahua, who are descendants of Geronimo, and the basic Mescalero Apache. This is at the 4th of July presentation. These are crown dancers. If you Google crown dancers, it's very, very spiritual dancers with the fire. I gave them dog care, free food, free water, free housing. They thought I was a bureaucrat. My wife was a teacher. They loved her. And so we were invited. So a lot of times we were the only white people at ceremonies judging. It was pretty, pretty cool. I want to emphasize the president, Mr. Chino, passed away years ago, but he was in charge of the Mescalero for 43 years. Under his leadership, they built a ski slope, they built a five-star hotel, they built bingo, horseback riding. He took that tribe where no tribe has gone before. When Dr. Bishop and I were in Albuquerque, we worked with the Navajos, who changed leadership every year. Back to the group dynamics course and culture. Wendell had a 737 with his insignia on the back, and when Congress would play games, he would fly in and walk in there in full dress. Truly amazing thing. I loved him because when I first walked in the meeting, he goes, "Mike, who do you work for, Public Health Service or me?" I went, "You." And he goes, "Good. Have coffee with me Thursday morning. We do no paperwork." He goes, "You go find out what's wrong. You have coffee with me. I'll fix it Friday." It was communication and working through it. The Boston Globe called him a warrior in the modern world. My second day on the Mescalero reservation, a knock on my door goes, "We have a dog problem, Mike." A dog pack had got together, attacked a young girl, bad wound on the head, and they were just basically feral dogs, just going crazy. We spotted the pack at the dump. Thank goodness I'm from Southwest Virginia. We went up there, Errol Utanatu and I, the animal control officer, were talking. He goes, "I think I'll turn the lights on." He turned the lights on, and the pack of dogs were coming right at us. Again, if you're an animal control activist, my apologies. Those dogs didn't make it. But this is true environmental health prevention, behavioral science on the reservation. Things are changed, but we still have a lot of culture to change. All right. In the late 80s, watching the time, cruise ships were just going insane, building. Gastrointestinal breaks were amazing. They weren't truly regulated. So CDC, Congress got together, hired six of us. We went up to Port Canaveral, and we wrote regulations in a week. We went through the Code of Federal Regulation process in a month. Dr. Wyckoff and I were talking under his time in FDA. It took years. We put the initial vessel sanitation manual together in 2 months. Why? Because it was crisis, outbreaks. We jumped on it. We used it. I use this to show you the Titanic was 883 feet long, 9 decks high, 46,000 tons. It held a lot of people. In the late 80s, the QE2 in the Norway weighed about 80,000 tons, and they had about 1,500 passengers. You had the wood decks, you had everything else. But in the late 80s, multiple outbreaks, and the cruise ships were just popping out. And so we went together, we put a public health program together to inspect, because average age, 65 years old. At the time, the majority of the crew was from third world country who did not understand our regulations. So I was tasked to put the training program together to train the crew, and it's still a very successful program. There's an example. If you go to the vessel sanitation program, you can see the manual that they update every year. You also can see the CDC, the cruise ship scores. And what I love about it, we set it up. It's a self-supportive program, whereas the cruise ship pays us to do the inspections per tonnage. The QE2, we used to charge them $8,000. If they failed, we come back. They never know when we were going to be there. They had pulled into port, and we go, "Welcome to America." And they had special codes, like the weather's fine today, which means Mike Gillenwater is aboard, hide everything. But it was a great relationship. When the boat would pull in, one of us would go do the galleys, and one of us would try to figure out the gray, the blue, the black pipes, where they were going, where there are any cross connections, and we had 6 hours to do it. And so we'd split up, we'd go, we'd do the ships. You can see the potential for problems. I signed up, I got to be the epi guy. We did Shigella outbreaks, we did Norwalk, means they can't find it, or other types, and we would go aboard and do it. This is taken by me in August, by the way. I'm in Nassau, and you can see, all right, you got one boat with a lot of people. Let's bring a lot of people in. You know, you have to have rat guards on the rope, but I'm going to, for time's sake, going to move quickly here. You get a few people together, you have a few problems. Right? Now, this would be my son, my son-in-law, and I suffering, looking at the hot tub last August. It was a tough inspection, but somehow I survived. Now, back to Desert Storm, Desert Shield in the 90s. Coast Guard has got an unbelievable mission. You got 38,000 people who just want to get it done. My job is to make sure they were safe and healthy. So we put that program together, and it was a true, tremendous thing. The Coast Guard mission, as you all know, is just people put themselves at risk from air rescue to people rescue to the environment every day. I was the deputy in fall of 84, and so we put this Vital Signs Safety and Health magazine together that we would spread to the fleet. You can see Operation Able Vigil, Cuba, Operation Able Manor. The Coast Guard mission is so sexy, but check this out. Hygiene, Health, and You, Let's Talk Turkey by Mike Gillenwater. Not the sexiest part of it, but my job was to protect the health of the field. You can see I'm over here in the uniform. I'm a little chubbier than I was back in Alaska. Technology's going, but that's what a public health service guy in the Coast Guard looks like. This was a HACCP, Hazard Analysis Critical Control Point course. I did my master's in certification food, and I did it everywhere I was, teaching, training. It's what it's all about. Now, I want to zero in. The Coast Guard mission was fantastic, but these are the slides that I want you in public health to see. This is a Haitian boat. I was aboard the chopper, and I took that one, then I took that one, and that one. Just think about HIV, Hep B, Hep C, TB, colds, flu, water, life. It just an amazing thing. So we said, how are we going to protect them and the coasties? So basically, I wrote a manual where you see we put a barrier. See the rope? Rope's an amazing thing. Immigrants stay on the back. Coasties stay here. We built a makeshift bathroom for them along the side. We fed them beans and rice twice a day. They were so thrilled. They risked everything to try to come to America. Now, you read about the Haitian and Cuban ops, but you've got basically indentured slaves coming from China, where they put them in a hole of a ship, and they're down there 6 to 9 months. You can see, when you go on a cruise ship, you have lifeboat drill. There's the Chinese immigrants' lifeboat drill. And these are graphic, but I think it's important you understand that this happens. They were there for 6 months. That was their life. They never got only if you were a cook did you get out. That's their dining table. That's their bathroom. It got to the point, feces would be everywhere. It does take your breath away, doesn't it? Am I moving around enough for you guys to see? And they didn't have shoes. That's their kitchen. Rice, rice, and rice. That's how they stored their chicken, salt water on the side of the ship. So, remember, my job is the health and safety of these coasties. HIV was becoming rampant. Hep B, Hep C's. My job, Admiral Steinman got me together and said, all right, Mike, I want you to train 38,000 people in 2 months. At that time, the state of the art was video. This was my introduction.
Now, in the course of your duties, you may have to deal with people who have bleeding wounds. These people might be medevac patients, personnel you encounter in law enforcement operations, or even your own shipmates or coworkers who are injured on the job. Your risk of getting HIV or hepatitis B from exposure to blood is very, very low, yet there's still a slight danger. This video will teach you how to protect yourself so that you can reduce that risk to essentially zero. So pay close attention to the information presented here. So as we continue to make the Coast Guard our nation's premier maritime service, we can all stay safe, healthy, and physically fit.
Because of AIDS and other blood-borne diseases, workers who are exposed to blood or other bodily fluids on a regular basis are required by law to take the proper protective measures. Your job function may have little to do with the handling of blood or other bodily fluids. Yet exposure could occur if you do not understand or respect the potential dangers. In this program, you will learn what blood-borne diseases are, how they can be transmitted, and proper protective measures. It is important to keep into perspective that a very small percentage of AIDS cases have occurred outside the identified high-risk areas. There is no need to overreact each time a coworker cuts a finger. On the other hand, one exposure under the wrong conditions could lead to a fatal disease.
The rest of the video, we got into the particulars of how it's epidemically, how it can be spread, the whole aspects of the diseases. But did that get your attention? It was fun. Your tax dollars at work, by the way. All right. Then I was tasked, and I'm going to blaze through the next in 5 minutes so we have questions. This is Dr. Bishop, would work out with the National Park Service, and I was honored to be the Public Health Service Consultant for West Virginia, Virginia, Maryland, and D.C. It was very taxing on the family. I worked 21 straight weekends for special events on the mall. I dealt with the Clintons. I dealt with Congress. I dealt with everybody. I was the only one that could close the kitchen down in the White House if the cook let me. Did you get that whole bureaucracy right there? If I found a problem, we would discuss how to fix it. So, Folklife Festival happens every year. It's around July 4th. There's a few people there. They gotta have food. My job was to inspect the vendors. That's Nelson Hoffman, a good buddy of mine for the Park Service. We would take the temperatures. We would just try to keep basic sanitation going. How do you wash dishes on a field event? Wash, rinse, and sanitize. This is what can be done in third world countries. If you teach the basics of wash, rinse, and sanitize, we taught the course. They had sushi, that's Charles Otto, who now runs the cruise ship program, doing an inspection there. Events everywhere at the White House. My wife enjoyed that tour because she got the Easter egg roll, the cherry blossom festival. She got nice ceremonies to go to. Google images, I did not take this picture, but you can see it's a lot clearer than the one I took. That's the White House kitchen. Anybody know where Camp David is? Guess. It's in the middle of Catoctin Mountain Park. You go in, you see the sign, do not enter. You go back, and there is Camp David. Their water system is back here, and it was unprotected when I took the job. I go, we may want to put a fence around the well that feeds the White House. Mrs. Clinton was famous for deciding to have a party the next day. I live in Fredericksburg, Virginia. I would get a call, oh, the Clintons are going to have a barbecue party tomorrow night. The truck's rolling up from Knoxville, and it'll be at Camp David at 5 a.m. I would go meet the truck, go in there, take time and temperature, and make sure the food was okay. There are the Clintons years ago. They've aged just a little bit in the kitchen at Camp David. Dr. Bishop and I threw this in there. We went up to teach we actually worked with the whole state, didn't we, Dr.? Yeah, Craig, we worked with the whole state. And we used to go to, and the Coast Guard, they used to tell me what kind of speaker I was, and they said, you put your hand in your pocket. I go, no, I don't. Well, I did. Okay, real quick, I retired. I worked for the local health department, West Nile virus, rabies, animal control. My favorite accolade with Gary Hagee, who ran the state food program, a graduate of East Tennessee State, master in health program. Gary and I worked together. I did a food safety over easy course. I did a two-hour course that I certified for local people to come through where I did time, temperature, and food. They didn't have to do the whole serve safe, but back to my master's of certification, let's get them done. 9/11 happened. It changed all our lives. I'm going to just do this slide presentation for you. As I said, I joined TSA to work with the equipment. They go, oh, you know how to defend the world against diarrhea and bad beer. So we red teamed it. This is Mr. Zinko's book. Basically, I like how it says, how to succeed by thinking like the enemy. Well, we try to outthink the enemy. We get to come up with scenarios that we think could really impact the world. My wife, I was on the school board. When you see all those little kids come out with the backpacks barely touching the ground, and they all come out to the buses, I see 700 kids together. Well, if I'm a bad guy, my mind starts to think. And I did the same thing with public health. Basically, make a long story short, we got to where 9/11 said, let's look at critical infrastructure, let's look at the pipelines, because guess what? I.e. the accidents on the Colonial Pipeline the past couple years. Gas prices go up. Pipelines depend on electricity to run their pipes. Electricity is dependent on oil to run the electricity. You break one of those infrastructures down, a lot happens to the East Coast. So, this is back up on the North Slope of Alaska. Alaska Pipeline was built in 1977. It basically, for time's sake, I'm going to just let you see. Notice how the pictures have changed a bit from my cameras. I crossed the Arctic Circle again, but this time in a heated car where I could take a nice picture. This is across the Yukon. This is the Trans-Alaska Pipeline. Vulnerable. Problem. I've gained a little weight. I've got a little gray hair. The pipeline's 48 inches in diameter. It takes about 12 days from a barrel to leave Prudhoe Bay to go down to Valdez. And it transpires now about 700,000 barrels a day, which equates, and it's how many, 19 gallons? One barrel of 42 gallons makes about 19 gallons of gas. Down to Valdez, where it comes out, the terminal. We had an Army Special Forces team, back to Red Team, try to sneak in on Valdez. You can't, because there's this little bitty mountain behind that no one can scale down. Have a bear having lunch. And then I was honored to step in with the FEMA mission to prepare, protect, respond, recover, and mitigate. FEMA has two grants programs. One's the recovery grant program, i.e. hurricanes, tornadoes, floods, the earthquake up in Northern Virginia. Those are the recovery grants, but I was honored to run the PREP grants, which the idea is to disseminate money to multiple different organizations for prevention of security. Our goal was to provide federal financial assistance to support the nation's citizens and emergency responders working in partnership to improve capabilities to respond, mitigate, and recover from natural and man-made disasters. Basically, be prepared. Those are the list of the grants program. If you go to grants.gov on FEMA, you can see from state homeland grant to fire prevention to smoke detectors in houses to especially volunteer firefighters, to get them PPE, personal protective equipment, and such. We felt like the grants make a difference. From under my time, 2013 to 2014, we disseminated $3.8 billion. It scared me to sign for that. If you haven't seen Patriots Day, go see Patriots Day. It's done very well. What it does emphasize is how important it is for our cameras to talk together. We can't prevent, you're just not going to prevent a terrorist attack, but you can minimize numbers and you can recover expeditiously if you're prepared. We were able to use the cameras, and the movie does it very well, of tracking these guys down, and I'm honored to say that our grant dollars bought a lot of those cameras. It's gotten to the point now, the state of New York City's getting ready to build three more layers of subways. Think about that. Three more layers of subways in the city of New York. What is that going to do in vulnerability? New York City's every camera, there's like seven ways to get in New York between bridges and tunnels. There are license plate readers that get every car coming across, and the city's, Macy's, Bloomingdale's, all their cameras work together. The transportation systems can, you drive into the city, they can track your car 100% of the time. Now, some people will say that's an invasion of privacy. They surveyed the city residents of New York, 99% said, do it. Why? Because they've experienced terrorism fresh, big time. The FLIR, the laser camera that verified, and you'll see in the movie, they think they're in there. We verified it through the camera. And that we're getting them. We're working on them. I blazed through. I stumbled a little bit, but I wanted you to get the perspective of a really blessed career. Any questions? Yes, ma'am. Yes.
And I was wondering if the reason that those measures are being implemented, or if there's a recalcitrance towards public health advancement because of cultural norms and customs, or if it's a lack of education, or both.
Or both. You nailed it. And it's not just the Alaska Natives. It's Appalachia. It's Rwanda. It's you've nailed it on. If you can change the culture as well as educate any way you can, because public health and security are in the same, I put them in the same bucket, because when there's an outbreak or a terrorist attack, everybody's willing to put education and money towards it. But if everything's fine for 5 or 10 years, we have other priorities. And you can never emphasize the importance of preventive medicine. And you do that, I think you nailed it right on the head. Education and cultural change. But you got to be careful and be respectful not to try to change the culture too much. You have to, by all means, meet the elders and be respectful to them. Good? Any other questions? Yes?
I understand the tribes have a special relationship with the federal government, to put it mildly, but along the way in these underserved areas, were you ever able to train people in state government who would be there for the long haul and kind of leave some infrastructure behind, sort of what we're trying to do in Tennessee now?
There is no question. For example, our grant dollars have to go through the state administrator of the state. So if we're trying to get those state dollars to the Cherokee, we've got multiple layers to go through. So I've stepped down as director, and I'm training to try to address exactly that. I think the underserved people in regards to grant dollars are the tribes and the local fire departments. And so we're trying to address that, just as you say. And we're trying to educate the state, and that's a constant battle. Any other questions? I can't tell you how lucky you are to be at East Tennessee State University. I think you need to embrace the faculty and they may get mad at me, stop by their offices. We talked about the importance of mentorship. Dr. Bishop, I didn't realize it because he's so much older than I am. He used to take me to lunch, and he mentored me. But we became a friendship to where we've kept in touch, and we generally care for each other. Don't miss out on that, because not only with your professors, but with your peers. I can pick up a phone with my fellow graduates from not only ETSU, but from Emory and Henry, from UVA. Make sure you connect and talk, because that's what it's all about, communication and understanding. Good? Great. I'm down here if you got any more questions. Dean?
Thank you very much.
Oh, thank you.